Okay, evening guys. Just to make sure, guys on that side, can you hear me as well? Okay, cool. So good evening and a big thank you to all of you who turned up, especially my friends. And also to of course Nicholas and Shilpa who have spent a lot of time organizing this event. So I actually asked Nicholas why did he invite me to come speak tonight, right? And he was like, oh yeah, you know Joelle, you did so many different projects, so many startups. I'm sure you have quite a few fuck ups and shit. I was like, okay, that's true. I think it's not just a few, I have a lot. So I'm going to try and squeeze in as many as I can in a short 7 minutes. So later feel free to ask me any questions or you can catch me right after the event if you want to find out a bit more about some of these fuck-ups as well. So, just to share a little bit more, I've been in the startup space for 10 years now, and why tonight is extremely exciting for me to share is because, you know, nowadays, especially the millennials, right, everyone is like, oh, I want to start my own startup after I graduate, oh, I have my own startup. Like, it seems very fun and super glamorous, but you know, we all know that those things that look like an overnight success, it's not that we suddenly lucked out or we got lucky. It's actually many, many, many sleepless nights and a lot of slogging, sometimes being like the janitor of your own office as well. So it's actually good to share the realities of running a startup. And of course, secondly, it's nice to be able to say fuck as many times as I want without saying like the words. Because that's the name of the event, right? So I would say that tonight my session would have been successful if you guys walk away from this session knowing a little bit better that it's important to take care of your health, because you know your body will not take anything you throw on it. And secondly, if you know how to take care of yourself a little better, so your mental and your emotional health. And also, of course, to start thinking about how all your failures and all your successes build up to the story that you'll eventually tell. So, the first startup that I started was very similar to what Tara was doing. So it was in the fashion e-commerce space, and maybe some of you might have heard of Dressabelle. We were one of the blog shops, you know, that started out when Asia was just starting to experience the whole e-commerce phenomenon. So back then, you know, I was in my early 20s. I was super bored of my day job in a corporate. So I started doing this as a side hustle. Back then it wasn't a startup, it was called I Need to Earn Some Extra Pocket Money. But, you know, I was just like, my body was young, I had so much energy. I could work 18 hours a day, 18 to 20 hours, and that was exactly what I was doing. I was sleeping 3 hours a day because at the peak of Dressabelle's business, we were actually the top e-commerce platform out of 50,000 in Singapore back in 2010. So we were releasing 250 SKUs a month. And I was clearing an average of 500 emails a day. So that was the Gmail send limit, if you guys remember. So, I mean, back then it was like, okay, I could sleep 3 hours, but think about sleeping for 3 hours for 7 months straight. And, you know, it came to a point in time where I felt like I was going to go mental because my body was just not keeping up with the rate of work that I was churning out. And when the opportunity for me to exit the business came in 2013, so a private investor actually came along, offered to buy out my shares. I was thinking, okay, I was choosing between my health versus continuing on with my baby. And back then, I decided that, you know, my health was way too important for me to lose. I can always start a business another time. And I decided to exit. So, of course, I had a happy ending to this story. But Dressabelle actually got acquired in 2016. So if you look at it back then, I mean, when that happened, you can say, oh my god, Joelle, like, you fucked up and like you exited way too early. But back then, you know, there were choices to be made, right? And what I was thinking of, the biggest lesson I learned is that, you know, I know that we're all hustling super hard. I know that you will do anything to keep your baby afloat. But just remember, you are the key driver for your business. And if you lose your health, you essentially are losing the key personnel for your business. So that was one big lesson I learned through this. So Dressabelle is still running, it has been acquired under the iFashion Group. So secondly, you know, I actually joined a couple of startups after that in the big data space. But you know, sometimes when you're entrepreneurial, right, like the first opportunity you get, you want to go start your own business again. So I actually started my second mobile/tech startup in the beauty and wellness space. So that was called GetKlarity. It is a beauty and wellness app for you to discover and book the top salons in Singapore. So honestly, back then it was more like a, hey, there's so many spots in Singapore, let's do it. What I learned was that, you know, to be an entrepreneur or a successful entrepreneur, sometimes it takes a mixture of determination, so that force that keeps you hustling and keeps you moving forward. And it also takes a lot of grit. And grit is that energy that keeps you standing firm when all the challenges come your way. And what I realized was that because I was in a space where I was more of an opportunist, I was like, hey, there's a gap in the market, let's go in. I didn't actually really have a passion for beauty and wellness per se. So when the challenges came, one after the other, sometimes 10 a day, like we were talking about fuck-ups with our term sheets, like fuck-ups with our merchants, like fuck-ups where I'm not sleeping for 40 hours straight. The passion, because it wasn't there, got me to eventually break down and say like, you know what, I had a great run, I'm gonna call it a day. And the funny thing was, I actually got my article published on Inc.com, kind of like at the start of starting GetKlarity, because, you know, I was talking about my failures, right? And I was like, yeah, I don't know, I'm on this new startup, I'm going to like learn from my failures and I'm going to succeed this time. But why I'm showing this picture is that, you know, even after sharing your failures, you can still fail. You know, and what I learned is that failure is really just an ongoing process. And it's about that perspective shift, right, that you can fail, but you can always look at it as a great learning experience, because we are always going to fail. And the biggest thing I learned about, you know, just leaving GetKlarity, I didn't exit, it's just dysfunctional, defunct, yes, it's defunct right now. So the thing is that what I learned, and I'm glad I learned, is that I know when to call it a day, and I know what it means to not let the failure of your startup determine or project onto failure of self. Because it's just, your startup is your startup, yes, it's your baby, but you can always start another startup. You can always go from one failure to eventually a success. But if you're going to take the failure of your startup so hard that you can't stand up again and you fall into depression, like that's GG, game over for you, you know? So just remember that failure is an ongoing process. Start collecting the stories and think about how each challenge, each struggle made you stronger and more ready for the success that's coming up. And so, you know, so just the last bit, eventually what happened was that I just decided that before I start my third startup, I really, really want to learn from the fact that, you know, I need to find something that I'm deeply passionate about. So I decided that it was time to go back into the whole learning, self-improvement stage, and I wanted to join another startup. So this is me at Honestbee, where I truly understand that struggle makes you stronger. But at the same time, the most fun project I did was the CSR project, where we were actually distributing food bags to some of the needy families during the Christmas season. And that was when I would say that it taught me that, hey, you know, business can generate social impact. Like, you can actually be generating social impact in the midst of doing business. And also, what I went on to next was actually a regional expansion role, because, you know, I've tried so many different projects, there's so many different startups, and what I realized I love to do is actually to go from the zero to one process, the launching process, starting things from scratch, feeling like you're going to die and cry every single day. Like, I love that. So why not turn that into something that feeds my lifestyle and brings me income, right? So I actually joined Wantedly as a market launcher, and it has been a great journey where, you know, it brought me to Japan, where I got to work with my Japanese colleagues. Of course, we also launched Singapore, which is my home market, and I actually spent the last 4 months or so in Hong Kong, where I met another diverse community of entrepreneurs. And every time you travel, you just realize just how much bigger the world is and how much more there is to learn and how much broader your perspectives need to be. So why I say this is because, you know, it is totally okay to rewrite your story. You know, everyone thinks like, hey, you have to be an entrepreneur, you have to own a startup. But, you know, your story is up to you to write. And I essentially went from being an entrepreneur to an entrepreneurial individual / entrepreneur / market launcher. You can be anything, you know, and there is no shame in saying like, hey, I'm not an entrepreneur anymore. Oh, hey, you know, I lost my startup. I mean, it is up to you to determine like how you want your story to be written and how you want to tell it. So what I will say is, you know, what is your story? What are the failures that you have that you are not proud to talk about? Maybe this is, tonight might be the night where we start sharing with more people who are out here to learn about how they can be better from some of the failures or some of the fuck-ups that you have made. And yeah, I'll just end off with saying, you do you. Thank you.
I think I've met Joelle about a year ago, and this is the first time I'm getting to hear in-depth, you know, stories about how all the journeys that she's been through. So right now, I'd like to open the floor for any questions that you might have for Joelle.
Hi, can you hear me again? Hi, my question to you is that in 2013, you said that you were sleeping 3 hours. And basically, I concluded that it was you had like too many tasks that you couldn't accomplish in 10 to 12 hours. Yeah. And in this stage, my question is, why did you delegate this task to be able to get on track with your health?
That's a great question, actually, because after joining other startups, what I learned is that in order to scale, you really need to start your knowledge management and you need to do delegation. And that is where you talk about, you know, process management and operations. But back then, you know, I was like, you know, power female founder, like sole entrepreneur, blah, blah, blah. I want to do everything because, you know, it's the typical case of like, I'm the best person to do the job, so I'll get it done. So very much focus on being efficient rather than effective. So that was a big learning lesson. I'm glad you brought it up.
I think you talked about determination, grit, passion, all of that. I think is about the founder, right? It's about how much vision you have. But how big a part was talent acquisition for you? Because it's a good part of the startup. And I think every day the big challenge for us is hire the right people, and you're always on a daily plan top, right? Because you have funding status, you have talent, you have to get out there, hire people. So what was that like for you, and how big a challenge was that to hire the right people or wait for that perfect candidate that may or may not appear?
So Raj, I think you just asked a 1 hour kind of question. Because previously I was in the HR tech recruiting space. So great question. I think it's a lot about assembling teams, and there are so many different frameworks for assembling teams. You have your co-founding team, you have your country teams, you have your core team. So the first thing that I'll say is that it depends on how large your team is at the moment, because if you're at stage one where you're just starting out, then of course that becomes your core team and everything is about the alignment to the vision. And at the same time, if I can just give a few quick tips, personally my guidelines is always passion over competency or attitude over aptitude, because attitude not so easy to change, aptitude you can always train a person. And secondly, you know, when you're a startup, I don't believe in throwing money to get good talent, because people are willing to compromise a little on the financial incentives if they are truly passionate about your business. And thirdly, think about what kind of employee share option plans you can put in place to really attract people who are totally, I won't say totally, there's no total, but who are aligned to your vision. And I would say one of the biggest thing also is that, you know, finding co-founders is almost as difficult as finding like a wife or a husband, because, you know, a lot of times at the start, when everyone's dreaming, everyone's super happy, right? It's so fun to like have beers and talk about how we are going to be a unicorn. But it's only in crunch time, like it's only under great stress where the true colors of an individual start showing. So take note and don't be too disappointed if people disappoint you, because it's bound to happen.
Thank you, Joelle. So we'll again have another round of Q&A in a bit after the 30.